NetSparker, the developers of desktop and cloud-based web application security scanners that enable you to automatically identify vulnerabilities in your web applications and web services. NetSparker scanners employ a unique and dead-accurate vulnerability scanning engine that automatically verifies vulnerabilities with their proof of concept. For more information, visit them on the web at netsparker.com or email at contact@netsparker.com. Recorded Future, they help security teams make more confident decisions faster. Recorded Future's technology automates broad collection and analysis of cyber threat data and delivers the rich external context you need to understand alerts and emerging threats. With real-time threat intelligence from Recorded Future, security teams respond to threats 63% faster and find undetected threats 10 times quicker. To get started, go to recordedfuture.com/securityweekly and sign up for the Recorded Future Cyber Daily. Every day, you'll receive an email with the top results for trending technical indicators, cyber news, exploited vulnerabilities, suspicious IP addresses, and more. Subscribe today and stay ahead of cyber attacks. Endgame's converged endpoint security platform is transforming security programs, their people, processes, and technology with the most powerful endpoint protection and simplest user experience, ensuring analysts of any skill level can stop targeted attacks before information theft. Endgame unifies prevention, detection, and threat hunting to stop known and unknown attacker behaviors at scale with a single agent. For more information, visit endgame.com.
Welcome back, everyone, to Paul's Security Weekly. Quick announcement, we need your help in a survey that we're running for research purposes for an upcoming webcast. We're asking the question, how mature is your process automation for various security capabilities? Please visit securityweekly.com/5stages of automation maturity to submit your responses to the, 5 stages of automation maturity survey. We will share the results in a webcast in November. I would like to welcome our guest for this segment. Stuart Room is a partner at PwC UK. He's the global leader of the cybersecurity and data protection legal services practice, the joint global leader of the multidisciplinary data protection practice, and the UK data protection practice leader. Stuart, welcome to the show.
Hi, it's really good to meet you all. Thanks for having me.
Yes, it's nice to have you here, Stuart. I guess, why don't we start out, Stuart, with a little bit about your background and how you came to be what I would term as the czar of data protection in the UK for PwC.
You're ever so kind. So I'm a lawyer, so an attorney in American money. And I used to wear a wig in court. And I used to go to court dressed up in a wig. And I first started to get involved with privacy issues as a trial attorney in the context of surveillance of personal injury claimants. So where people were suing for compensation after an accident, occasionally the insurance companies for the defendant would engage in videotape surveillance of the claimant with the intention to try and show that they were malingering or swinging the lead, as we'd say in the UK. Mm-hmm. And there were a number of occasions in court where I had to look at the admissibility of evidence. Mm-hmm. And one of the issues that, you know, I started to really understand at that time was that this surveillance evidence interfered with the right to privacy. Mm-hmm. And that was the beginning of my journey, and all the way through, you know, that eureka moment. There was the Y2K millennium bug stuff was going on. .com was coming on, and to me, in the late 1990s, there was this realization of mass reliance on computers for fundamental economic issues, and they're all going to fall down and fail. And what's that look like? And it would have privacy issues as well as security issues in. So as a lawyer, I've moved forward from there and ultimately now, you know, at PwC.
You know, it's interesting that, you know, we talk about stuff that was happening in the early 2000s or late 90s as when we acquired software, there would be that end user license agreement, right? Now, today, yeah. We transform that into there's some type of acceptable use policy, privacy policy, all these different policies that will come up every once in a while. And as users, we go, that's nice. I just want to use the service. Yes, I agree. Most of us don't know what we're agreeing to. Now, if we even take the time to read them, understanding how they will use my data, what data they're using in what capacity is extremely complex. And many of us can't figure it out. What can we do, Stuart, to improve the situation so that we at least know how they might be using our data and what data they're using?
Yeah, you're right. And if you talk about the EULA, you know, take one step further back in time, we would have shrink wrap, wouldn't we? So yeah, you would buy some computer software in a box, it would be wrapped up in plastic, and we'd rip it off and, you know, we'd try and stick that 3.5-inch disk into the desktop, whatever it may have been. And we never read it, and it's moved past that point now. I think that, you know, the real challenge is, from a privacy perspective, is to really try and home in on what are the critical points of concern, rather than just writing acres and acres about anything. So put forward the critical points. And there's other ideas about being creative. So there's this suggestion or this idea that all of the information needs to be provided in one go at the very beginning of the transaction. But that may not necessarily be correct. So, you know, if, let's say you think about digital assistants, you know, you've got so many of them now. They're able to interact with you orally in real time. And why do they need to provide all of this information in an old-fashioned way? Why can't it be part of a dialogue that you're having with the digital assistant? You know, other organizations are wondering about, you know, the extent to which video and imagery itself can convey more meaningful messages than printed text. So I think the space is for you know, for evolution and improvement in thinking, but also people trying to be realistic about what needs to be expressed rather than just trying to capture everything.
Yeah, I feel like we're on the cusp of having a better experience for the users to be able to, one, understand what data is being collected, how it's used, and then have some control over that, and then understand the benefits or the negative side of how I want to let people use my data, which is interesting because many, even myself sometimes, I'm like, yes, you may use that data. And then I think about it later. I'm like, wait, that could be bad, right? And so understanding the repercussions is important too.
Yeah, exactly right. And if you take this idea again about, you know, what do people need to know and what do they already know? So, you know, you've got people in my generation who their experiences with technology and data processing, they've arrived at through their career and life choices. Whereas, you know, kids going through school are being taught about particular priorities of, you know, the online environment. And they're going to come out into being, you know, adult computer users with a degree of computer literacy. So whatever is said in the transaction should be additive to what's already known. And I think there is that space for significant improvement. If we can focus on the priority, then there is a better chance to explain it and make it understood. But I think the flip side of your point is, to what extent is the data use intended to be secret, or is it accidentally secret, or to what extent could there be purpose creep and future use that has not been contemplated at the moment of detection, or rather collection of data? I think that's where it gets really interesting.
And that's where Matt Alderman and Lee Neely are here with us for this segment.
Yeah, and I think that's where things get really interesting with platforms like social media, right? Where you're using a platform, you've agreed to the initial terms, but you don't know what they're doing with some of that data in the background, or maybe you don't care, but at some point you do care. And it gets really interesting is because you have a lot of these services that are out there and you don't really know what's happening with your data. And we've seen cases, Stuart, around Cambridge Analytica and what they were using data for without people's consent.
Not even just that, but once you put it on social media or the internet, it's out there.
It's out
and
there.
And the youth today is like, well, you know, like with Snapchat, they, you know, they restrict, you can't take a screenshot. I'm like, what if their friend is standing over their shoulder and they take a picture of your phone with their phone? How do you control that? So once your information is out there, you know, legitimate and illegitimate uses are both valid to how your data will be used.
Yeah, I mean, there's no question that we know this is a security program. The people who watch this understand the nature of data and how it's copied in the digital environment and it's remained permanent. But it's interesting, you know, the idea about the Snapchat stuff and the photograph over the shoulder. I think, you know, that's kind of falling in the category of issues that you know, kids are being taught about at school. So, you know, we'd sort of understand with a little bit more, you know, awareness around the issues that you need a privacy screen on your laptop when you're on the on, right. the, on the train, and watch out for people over your shoulder, just like using an ATM. The point about this function creep or this purpose creep, and there's a spectrum from accidental creep through to deliberate creep, and through to, you know, future uses that have never been contemplated. It's a very broad spectrum of issues. To me, it takes you to the point where you've got to start thinking about how do you treat the data itself, you know, rather than how do you treat the contractual relationship between the user and the computer screen or the mobile device. What do we need to do inside the data elements themselves in order to limit the purpose creep that we're talking about? How do we do that? And I think that's for me where the evolutions in data privacy are going to be found. That's where they'll be. That's where the innovations are going to be.
So, Stuart, do you mean, like, rather than storing my full birthday, maybe it's just my birthday month, or do you also mean encryption of the data as well?
Yeah, so it could be. I mean, I'd potentially give a different example. So if you think about how the relationship between an organization and a user is essentially regulated, it's a contractual relationship. You talked about EULAs and things like that. It's a relationship of paper. It may be electronic paper, but primarily it's about a promise conveyed between two people, and you hope that the promise will be obeyed. But the problem is, like any contract or any promise, you know, arguably they're there to be broken, and we have hundreds of years of litigation around contractual failure. So what I'm really trying to drive at is that we need to find a way of embedding our promises in a way that can't be broken, or that limit the ability for them to be broken. And if the promise that you have is one that leads to the conveyance of data, it seems to me that the very nature of data will enable the promise to be coded into the data elements themselves. So if the promise is the data shall be deleted after a year,
right,
or the data shall not be shared outside the organization, or whatever the promise is, rather than relying on the paper of a contract, you can code these in. And that's where the encryption point that you just made becomes really interesting, because security by its very nature has understood the need to code security into data itself, rather than simply relying on an ISO 27001 policy framework to hope that security is going to be good.
Yeah,
you know, paper doesn't translate into a cyber and digital world very well.
Right.
Coding does.
Yeah, and that goes to John Strand's point yesterday, where we're talking about blockchain, and he's in his assessment, which I agree with, that databases and database engineering and architecture largely provide a facility to encrypt and protect the data, to speak to your point, Stuart, rather than relying on some other newer technology
right.
to do it. And he's like, this is a tried and true method.
Yeah, okay. You're right, Paul. Sorry, I didn't want to sort of like dominate the conversation, but so tell me if I am. Mm-hmm. But it's really interesting that last bit that you just talked about encryption, is really interesting, because in a data privacy world where I operate, there's a bunch of principles that matter. So the accuracy of data, mm-hmm. the purpose for data use, minimizing and retaining data. And one of them, security. Security is a principle of data protection, data privacy. You shall keep personal information secure. So when an organization procures encryption technology, generally speaking, it's procuring it for a security purpose. But actually, encryption technology can be dual usage, it can be multi-usage, it can be used for other privacy principles. So for example, if you through encryption were to end of life data, not only is that a security goal achieved, it's a privacy goal achieved in terms of minimization of data life. And I think there's a fantastic opportunity for the security professional to actually show the privacy professional some of the way, and equally for the privacy professional to be able to explain to the security professional that they are already sitting on deployed technology that could have considerably greater benefit, you know, inside the organization. And encryption is a really great example of that. It's both security and privacy.
Yeah, I mean, part of my three tenets for security for the future have always been around app, user, and data. As we see this transformation going on digitally and adoption of cloud and other things, I've always been this big proponent that if I can protect the application, I can protect the user, and I can protect the data, you know, we're in a better position from a security perspective. Data's always been that really, really hard one. If we could protect the data, think about all the other security things we may not have to do, because regardless of where the data is, it's protected all the time. So even if it fell into the wrong hands, potentially you could
protect it from those that don't have the key to decrypt it.
That don't have the key to decrypt it, right? That's where like concepts of homomorphic encryption are these nirvanas, where if I had all this data encrypted all the time, regardless of where it was, then the attackers who don't have the key can't access the data. But we're not there yet. And I don't see, I've seen some evolution in this space, but data has always been the holy grail from a security perspective. But yet, I don't know that we're spending the cycles on doing a better job of protecting data.
And protecting the keys.
I think you're absolutely right. You see, if the way organizations often approach security and privacy issues is that they've perceived a technology issue rather than necessarily a data issue. And for example, if you want to achieve an outcome, let's say a CRM, how do I get better customer insights? The answer is you deploy a massive CRM with lots of functionality, and that therefore generates more data and therefore more privacy and security risk. Whereas if we were to start from the conversation in a different way and say, what type of intelligence is the business seeking to gain that is missing? It might be the case that the data already exists and you've got to build a conduit between the data. It may not be a technology solution at all. It may just be another way of looking at data. Mm-hmm. And I think there's a very, very big space between technology and data. And they're not the same, but very often they're perceived to be the same. Or worse than that, technology is perceived to be the only issue that matters. Mm. And I wouldn't agree that that's the case.
That's a great point. Lee, did you have a question, comment?
Yeah, I had a question. So, I mean, tagging on to, I would make an appendix to Matt's comment that it needs to be strong encryption that's not easily defeated. But I think that was implicit in what he was saying. But what I was wondering is, I was thinking about this, and we mentioned scope creep briefly, and I remember back many years ago, you had the EULA you'd agree to, and there was sort of a continued use of the services constitutes agreement to the current EULA of the day, whatever it is, and you didn't see it. And nowadays, when they get updated, you get prompted to reaccept them. And my question is, do we think people actually are reading those enough to understand what they're agreeing to? I think maybe not. Even if you throw it up in front of them every day, I really don't think they know what they're sharing. Or am I going too far?
No, I don't think you're going too far at all, because I'm a lawyer by profession and training, and I practice still as a lawyer, even though in my role at PwC it's a multidisciplinary role. I still do court cases, but I would confess to not reading all the terms and conditions that are put before me, because it's not just a question of laziness or anything like that. It's also a question of expediency and time, and there's other considerations that, the other day I was trying to get a flight. I was getting a flight back from the States, and I realized that I had to go domestic and then international, and the layover was too short. So I had to somehow figure out how I got from Terminal 2 at JFK to Terminal 4. In the plane was about to take off. I'm not going to read the terms and conditions to find out that information about how I get from two terminals on time. So you've got those issues. But what's happening with those EULAs, primarily, or the terms and conditions, is they're addressing a legal problem. You see, they're born from the idea of contract and permission. There's something both in the United States and in Europe and other countries that's at the origin of those things, and it's a legal origin. And we forget about that because, we risk, by continuing a legalistic approach, we miss the points that you are rightly making, which is, you know, am I able to understand? Is the information too dense, or I just don't have enough time and it's not appropriate?
Yeah, I mean, the layperson reading one of those contracts probably wouldn't understand it anyways, whereas and for withs and I mean, if you've ever gone through and read a contract and tried to figure out where the gotchas are, I mean, most lay people just wouldn't understand it anyways. They just click accept.
And I don't understand a lot of the legalese and the contracts, right? And it's an interesting situation that if I'm trying to understand it and I'm asking an employee of the organization who's this is the policy, you know, that's not their legal team, let's say. They're just pointing me back to the policy, right? They don't want to try and interpret it and then interpret it wrong. And oftentimes it comes down to how they define data. And we ran into this with YouTube.
Yeah.
They were saying you need to do something specific based on YouTube data. And I was like, well, what is YouTube data? How do you define that? Which pieces of information? And that can be, in today's world, very interesting to describe what constitutes even what the data is, right?
Mm-hmm. You're exactly right. And, you know, just take it one step further. Why do we have court cases? And the answer is because even the lawyers can't agree on it.
Yeah.
You know, why do we have, you know, federal courts, state courts, federal courts, and the Supreme Court in the states? Because the judges can't agree on it either. And, you know, the problem you've got is it's not just the layperson. And what I think is going on at the very heart of this, you know, the real issue is the question of business silos, that the business has functions that do particular things. So there's a function that delivers technology, there's a function that delivers data, there's a function that delivers legal outcomes, and they all contribute their bits and pieces of the jigsaw. And then what you get is, you know, it's a picture of something that you recognize and you call it, you know, an app or a website, etc. But it's still a jigsaw puzzle. And there has been no real breaking of the barriers. So the, you know, the data scientist is not conversing with the lawyer, who's not conversing with the marketing department to say, what is it that we're actually seeking to achieve right now in totality in light of our gain issues and the customer's usage issues? What is it? Instead, we just contribute jigsaw puzzle pieces. And hey, presto, no surprise, you're going to see terms and conditions that are impregnable because they're not being thought about other than as a jigsaw puzzle piece.
Yeah, and it's a balance of business operations, right? And we've seen a lot of cases, not cases like legal cases, but a lot of instances where the APIs for a lot of these services that are online are basically leaking too much data, right? The security researchers are like, if I query it in this way, by the way, I can get little bits of information here, I can cross-reference that with other little bits of information, and lo and behold, I can construct an attack. And the response has been largely that the organization who hosts the API and the service is like, yeah, well, that's not a problem. Like that needs to be accessible. And they're in this really interesting predicament today, I believe.
I think you're absolutely right. You know, it's a classic usage versus risk, isn't it?
Yeah.
Predicament. So if you can't operate in a risk-free environment, if you're going to start using data, except it to have security challenges that are appended to it, I completely agree with you. It's not a zero-sum game, and these things don't always net off. And the other side of this, this risk reality is we've got to also remember the need for innovation that digital and technological and cyber era has brought just so much potential. You know, so much liberalization of thought, you know, the addition of freedom of speech and it has the ability to propagate ideas. And we all know the adages about in knowledge there is power. So we want to have an environment that is innovative and thrives. And that environment has got to be an environment that also includes risk.
Yeah.
No, and I think it's that risk component that a lot of people don't fully understand or don't analyze to really understand. What is the impact of doing these things from a standard business process perspective?
Right.
And I think that's one of the big challenges for a lot of organizations. They don't think about the risk aspects of it as much.
I think you're exactly right that they don't. And here's a little interesting vignette. So if you think about data privacy law, so you know your watchers, your viewers know about the GDPR in Europe and the CCPA in California. I mean, these are not the first iterations of data privacy law. I mean, the data protection ideas were invented in about 1968, you know, just before I was born. So 50-odd years old. And we've had iteration of law built upon iteration of law. Anyway, my point is this, is that the GDPR that was adopted in 2016 in Europe, the General Data Protection Regulation, contained express legislative provisions for risk assessments. Why? Well, why would it do that? And the answer is because the law figured out that people weren't doing risk assessments. I mean, you know, there's an irony there that something that is 50 years old needed to be amended to include a legal obligation to a risk assessment. I mean, isn't that the most basic element of business, a risk assessment? So to your point, I'm not confident that risk assessments are properly understood in a digital or cyber environment.
Yeah, definitely true.
Lee?
So I was wondering, you know, we talked a lot about individuals. Are businesses understanding the data, like when they're outsourcing? I'm trying not to say the word cloud. I want to be more generic. Just when we're outsourcing somebody else to trust their business data, are they doing the review? Are there conversations that aren't happening that should be happening in the privacy space? I mean, should they be calling their privacy lawyer to really put my thumb on it? But that's not really, I didn't want to go that specific.
Yeah. Well, I mean, just take the last point first, is that, you know, I don't believe that the solution to data privacy challenges, including in the supply chain and outsourcing environment that you just mentioned, is the lawyer. You know, I believe it's a multidisciplinary stakeholder community. Mm-hmm. So, you know, to what extent the lawyer would be technologically savvy is a challenge. To what extent would the technologist be savvy about commercial procurement is a challenge. You need to bring in the multidisciplinary team to actually say, okay, this business is going to outsource, whether it's the cloud or not. What does that involve? It involves these ideas of technology being built, data being transferred, commercial deals to be made, and law to be applied, and a user experience ultimately to be guaranteed. Right, what are the issues we now need to resolve? Instead, what often happens is, you know, the security person will see his jigsaw puzzle piece and think, right, okay, what I need to do is get some, you know, attestation of security, I don't know. Have you subscribed to NIST? You know, do you do the NIST thing? Show me some evidence. Do me a SOC 2. And then the commercial guy will say, yeah, I just need to make sure that there's, you know, clauses bolted in that look legalistic in the contract. Phone up the lawyer and ask them to do that. And against this silo and jigsaw puzzle piece idea, rather than, you know, a holistic response to what is the challenge of outsourcing that you're rightly pointing to.
Yeah, I mean, my early days into the governance risk management compliance space was running the third party vendor management program for one of the top 10 national banks in the US. And it was 70,000 vendors. And, you know, it was on the security team to go out and analyze all these relationships to determine whether they were secure or not. And what you start to realize, Stuart, is that security only owns a part of that, right? They can go out and do aspects of a risk assessment, say, well, what kind of data are we sending to the outsourcer? And this was before cloud, right? I mean, this was back in the early 2000s where people were just outsourcing functions left and right. But you had to go through and understand what kind of data did they have? Was it publicly facing, et cetera, a risk assessment? Then based on that, identify what potential security controls are in place. But then you'd go through all that work and then the business is like, yeah, but we need to use this vendor. Even though they had potentially a high level of risk, the business had to be involved. Procurement had to be involved, legal from a contract perspective. And so you're right, Stuart. The way we saw these in the early days was a bunch of little groups kind of had their little pieces. I've seen some improvements in that sort of aspect, but I still don't think it's fully integrated for people to understand all the risk aspects of a third-party relationship when it comes to data. There's financial risk, there's reputational risk, there's contract legal risk, and there's security risk, all kind of embedded in there. And I think we're still way behind understanding all that.
Yeah, I think you've put it perfectly, Matt. I mean, that picture of the past is, you know, as you're alluding to, sadly, is still the picture of the current and the present. I mean, you know, I've seen situations where you've got all those jigsaw puzzle pieces on the table, but yet the business takes an arbitrary financial threshold to determine risk. And get right. If a contract's worth, I don't know, over $100,000, then it goes through the procurement stuff. And if it's worth $99,000, it just do it in the business function. And as if security and privacy risk issues are appended to those kind of arbitrary financial values, it's nonsensical. You know, contract value and risk are not the same. So there is a lot of space for improvement in the procurement cycle. No question.
Yeah. I mean, the perfect example for me was when I walked in, they were assessing all their large vendors, you know, all the big vendors that were out there. And lo and behold, I find this little mom and pop shop that was printing statements for the wealth management customers, and they had the social security number. The threshold from a dollar perspective didn't bubble up, Stuart, to your point, where they were assessing the mom and pop, where all their wealth management customers' social security numbers were sitting in this print shop without any understanding of the risk of losing aspects of that data. And we're talking wealth management customers, right? So these are your big clients that have a lot of money sitting in your banks. Wasn't even on the radar because they were using dollar value of the contract as a threshold, not understanding the true risk of what that service was doing.
Yeah. And the thing is, you know, just as you were saying this, Matt, you know, obviously we weren't acting on the same case or the same matter, were we? I mean, the point being is that idea of the financial value being the single arbiter of risk is common. It's not, an anecdote from the past. This is really common. And it becomes more common because if you start to think about, you know, where Lee was, he brought in the cloud idea. If you start to perpetuate the conversation around outsourcing third-party risk in the data and tech environment, well, we know what the data and tech environment is. Yes, it does have massive behemoths within it, you know, huge giants. Of course it does. But they all started off as small little things, you know, in Silicon Valley and other, you know, incubator and hubs. And they grow. And so much dynamic activity in tech and data is in organizations that are the digital equivalent of the mom and pop store, aren't they?
Mm-hmm.
If you take dollar value and number of employees, that footprint, yeah, you can do a lot of damage with to people in a digital and cyber environment with very little resources.
Yeah, when the business unit had the ability to go bring up a service, put it on their credit card, bypass procurement altogether, right? The old days of shadow IT.
Yeah.
Nobody was looking at that from a risk perspective, say, well, what data are you putting up in that little service that you're spending a few thousand dollars a month on the corporate card that you're expensing on your expense report? It was completely lost.
Yeah. There is obviously a value to data, right? And one of the things that Brian Lamoureux brought up was the testimony from Mark Zuckerberg, where he made some allusion that we're not charging people today or currently to use Facebook, right? At what point, Stuart, do you see it going to, rather than monetizing on our data, the social media networks are just going to charge us to use the service and offer some level of protection?
Yeah, so, I mean, obviously, without, you can't speak about specific examples as such, you know, but you've hit on a really, really significant issue, and we've not rehearsed this. I actually did a conference about this issue today, you know, in the UK, in London, with a whole load of clients in, because there's been some judgments in Europe over the past 2 days. There was a very big judgment in the European Court of Justice about the cookie consent environment. Mm-hmm. And then in the UK, there was a very big judgment in the Court of Appeal about the Safari workaround issue from a few years ago. And anyway, what they're driving to in a European environment is essentially the viability of the business model, which has the free service provided in exchange for data value. Mm-hmm. So rather than me paying for a social network or a search engine, they will extract some of their revenue from my data value. And these cases are challenging that. And it is potentially possible that the law in Europe could start to deliver those outcomes where some of the free models disappear or are reduced in you know, in size. And the more that we attack the essentially the ad network environment and the data-driven marketing environment, the greater is the potential you just mentioned that at some point, where is the revenue going to come from? Right. And we may end up in a world, you know, not too far out where you have different systems. You may have, you know, a free system in the United States, and you may have to have a paid for system, you know, in somewhere in Europe. And, you know, that's going to be a complicator both for the customer, where we're going to just going to not make any easier for us, right? It's just more confusion. But also it's going to not be easy for the business as well. So I think it's a real issue. It's a really, really good issue.
Yeah, and it's a balance for the business too. You know, you can spend lots of money trying to protect people's data and use that to monetize. At what point does that become too costly? And you're like, it's just better if we charged every user a couple dollars a month or a year or whatever.
Exactly, right.
Depending on how large your Facebook, right, could charge a couple of dollars per user per year maybe and still make
and offset all that
lot of money.
Loss of revenue that they're
paying out in fines and you know, associated with the cost of trying to protect people's data.
Right. Yeah. And I think GDPR is where a lot of this precedent law is going to come from, right? True. I mean, these cases are now coming into the EU from a GDPR perspective, and I think they're going to set a lot of precedents on what constitutes privacy violations and eventually how do these systems morph and change, and maybe their revenue and business models have to morph and change along with it.
Yeah, that's exactly the point. You know, you're right. You know, the GDPR is going to drive a huge amount of this. And, you know, the two cases that I just mentioned are built upon sister data protection regime to the GDPR. You know, it's from the same fraternity. I have this feeling that in some of the regulatory offices that there is a real pragmatism that getting the balance right between the free service and data privacy is not as easy as the law may suggest, and that the business models and the infrastructures upon which the global data environment, you know, the web and the internet, etc., are built, are not as easy to unpick as we might imagine when looking purely at the law. So there is a corresponding factor in this that there might be a the pragmatism of some regulatory offices might act as a brake on the GDPR's ability to propel business models ultimately down a direction that are not ones that are good overall for society. And for me, you know, there's something really important in this, is that this debate about is it a free service or is it a paid for service may have within it a potential for an unintended consequence, that those things may propagate monopolies and duopolies. So you go back again to the idea of the startup, you know, the startup that has delivered the innovation, and all these technology companies were startups at one point in time. Mm-hmm. They began from a free base, and that's how they got their user base. And it was from that position that they could grow. If you end up in a situation where the law forces paid or not, I think that produces monopolies, because
it could also stifle innovation.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's precisely the point. Exactly right. You know, so you've got to be very, very careful. Again, this is about silos and jigsaw puzzles, that we've got to be cautious to not think about solutions, whether through the GDPR or other instruments, as being ones which only the legal system should input into. I think it's very, very important that, you know, people like yourselves, people like your viewers, your listeners, you know, people with more things to contribute are able to contribute to what is the better solution. Because I'm not, as a lawyer, I think it's fair to me to say that lawyers don't have all the solutions.
Yeah, it's interesting how it plays into the economics and capitalism and innovation.
Any
really regulation, right? In any side of it either, right? Because, you know, we talk about how businesses use other business services and how they can dictate basically anything they want, right? Well, how does that bode for the startup that wants to start collecting data and make these relationships? But now there's a cost, right, associated with that, right? I mean, you look at Amazon, and I want to host it in Amazon. Right now there's lots of great free options. What if that goes away? What if they're like, hey, you gotta pay, right?
Yeah, and there were some recent judgments around Google. I think last week or a couple weeks ago, Stuart, I don't know how familiar you are, but it had to do with the Google search engine and some of the. I think instead of applying the requirements across all of Google, it was kind of limited to the EU. So there we've seen some interesting judgments as well, where not the whole of Google gets impacted, but specific, I think it was specific search engines within the EU countries did have to meet the requirements of GDPR, but Google as a whole didn't have to, or something along those lines.
Yeah, Matt, you're right. So, you know, you're very on top of European legal developments. Well done. You're right. It's the right to be forgotten case. And, you know, this is the right to be forgotten case in litigation first established itself in 2014, in autumn 2014. And it was a case involving Google Inc. and Google Spain. And it was about the obligation of the global search engine to de-link to websites that contain personal data, which was, you know, out of date and irrelevant. So that's the principle of the right to be forgotten. There's been this real tension about inside the development of that law about whether European law should apply itself to the globe or whether its reach should not extend past the physical and then virtual and logical jurisdictions of Europe. And the case you mentioned, Matt, it held that as far as the right to be forgotten is concerned, that would only operate in the context of search engines that are accessible to people in Europe. So the solution then is one of, you know, geo-identification and then geo-lockdown.
Right.
The segmenting the World Wide Web, you know, in that way for the purposes of the right to be forgotten.
It's just an interesting judgment because so much of what we think about GDPR and the right to be forgotten, kind of a lot of people think part of that applies to all EU citizens regardless, and therefore it does impact potentially the globe, but that ruling kind of limited what the scope of that jurisdiction was, which was an interesting one, because we hadn't seen that kind of precedent set yet.
Yeah, that's right. And there are a few other cases around that, but the judgment that I mentioned before that happened in the United Kingdom in the Court of Appeal is a judgment that has a different tone to it, where there is a longer arm reach of data protection law in that particular case than there is in the right to be forgotten case. Anyway, my point really is that we have not yet got to a stage where we're confident about the jurisdictional scope and ambit of the GDPR. The right to be forgotten in that particular case last week tells us it's limited. Other cases say not so. And you know, you get this in the States all the time, don't you, where different states come to different judgments and different conclusions. Absolutely. I mean, it happens here.
Yeah. Lee, go ahead.
I had a related question, just because it's something I was having a conversation with the other day. Is, I mean, we're used to thinking about European privacy laws covering all of Europe, including the UK. What happens with Brexit? Not to bring up a sore point, just wondering. we were having an interesting conversation. Yeah. What does that do to the mix?
Yeah. So no, it's not a sore point. I mean, it's absolutely undeniably an issue. So yes, I mean, it's a real complicator actually. So Theresa May, the former prime minister, as you know, had a negotiated withdrawal agreement that failed to get through the UK Parliament 3 or 4 times. I can't remember the exact number, but you know, it was not a success. But had that been passed, then the UK, at least for the transitional period after Brexit, would have operated in accordance with the European scheme, and international data flows could continue from Europe to the UK. If we get a no-deal Brexit at the end of the month, you know, 31st of October, there will be some mechanisms that could be used by a UK entity to maintain data flowing from Europe to the UK. But there is no mechanism that Europe has agreed to that would sanction the UK then sending it on to the United States or elsewhere. So that's going to create a problem in terms of that, the linkage of data flows once it comes out of Europe and goes to other countries. So we don't have an answer to that. Lee, you know, I think a lot of people, including myself, are, you know, hoping that the knights will ride to the rescue and a deal will be done and all of these issues will go away. But it's not just data privacy that is going to be a real challenge if that those knights don't turn up, I'm afraid. But international data flows is going to be a problem.
Yeah, I didn't want to trivialize that. I mean, there's a lot of interesting things that could go on. I just was thinking with privacy or some company worrying about implementing their share of the GDPR, like a Google, what happened to the equation? I think the answer is we don't know yet. Just stay the course and hope for the best.
Yeah, you're right. No, you certainly weren't trivializing it, Lee. No, not at all. You're right. We don't know. And data protection is just one of many, many issues involved in that.
Just like we don't know what's going to happen in the states after, you know, California's law goes into effect. There's other states looking at it. Are we going to do something at the national level? You know, we'll have some of these same interesting conversations, I think, ourselves as soon as the California privacy law goes into place, because the scope of jurisdiction around California versus the rest of the country, that'll get interesting too.
It's actually interesting along those lines. Brian Lemereau, after he came on our show, presented at a conference, and he said he was in watching a documentary that he credits to. Basically, we were going to get a GDPR-like law in the U.S. just before September 11th, 2001. After that, we got the Patriot Act instead.
Right.
And I think it's taken us that almost 20 years to start coming back around to putting this legislation in the federal, in the U.S. courts.
Yeah, I mean, that's absolutely right. And there was an interesting point there as well that, you know, obviously after the tragedy of and the atrocity of 9/11, there had to be multiple reactions, and within that, one of the multiple reactions was to reinforce security law, and the Patriot Act, you know, did that. And what we see in lawmaking for privacy and security is an oscillating pendulum that reacts to significant events at significant points in time. If that atrocity had not happened, then I agree the probability is that there would have been privacy laws sooner as a probability. But the other thing to remember, and I think this is really interesting, this is where America doesn't get the credit that it deserves, is Europe regulates everything. It's an omnibus regulation, but who says that's right? You know, why? Why is that? You know, why is that the best regulatory regime? No one's actually explained the answer to that. We can understand how we got there, but no one says it can explain why it's the best. Whereas in America, we've had a history of sectoral regulation around matters that you recognize as being privacy matters in Europe. You know, you've got CAN spam, and you've got COPPA, and you've got GLB, and you've got HIPAA. And then, you know, in terms of security breach notification law, you know, developed in California in 2003, you know, America led the way on that. And you've got the Privacy Act 1974, which deals with, you know, the offices of governments and public authorities. So there is a huge amount inside the American regime that already echoes or indeed has informed European law, including law inside the GDPR. We have personal data breach disclosure as a mandatory obligation in Europe because of the GDPR, and that's because America invented it and gifted it to the world.
We just gifted 50 versions of it, though.
Right. Yeah. In pieces and parts, spread out all over the place. Right.
Yeah. Which makes it hard for a lot of organizations to manage against varying regulations. I think where an omnibus potentially has its benefits, Stuart, is the rules apply the same to everybody. Where in the States, when you do it in that jurisdictional approach, then you end up with 50 variations that now have to be managed to, and that adds complexity. So, you know, there's a pro and a con to both of those environments, I think.
I absolutely agree. I absolutely agree. And you know, my question about why is Omnibus the best does not, of course, prevent the answer. Yes, it is the best. Right. you know, there is a lot to be said for Omnibus measures because, you know, the thing that business wants more than anything else is clarity and certainty. That, you know, if you were to be, you know, ask the CEO of all the major businesses around the world, you know, what would you hope to get? It would be a single level playing field in all territories, and whether for privacy or not. So that there is something massive in your point there, Matt. But then there's another side to it, which is about priority as well. And, you know, if you think about how successful the regulatory regime in Europe has been about changing behaviors, well, the jury is out. It's a mixed picture. Yes, there are some very large fines that have been coming through, or potential fines under the GDPR recently. But again, if you look at what America's been delivering by way of regulatory sanctions for bad privacy and security, you know, America can proudly make the argument that it is the most effective regulatory system, you know, on the planet. Someone may then retort, well, you know, it doesn't take much, but that's a different point.
That's really funny. Any final questions for Stuart?
No, I'm good. This was great.
Stuart, that was fantastic. Awesome. Yeah, thank you so much for appearing on Paul's Security Weekly.
Well, thanks for having me, Paul and Matt, and nice to see you, Lee. I think you've got a great show, and
thank you.
You know, really look forward to watching all your fantastic updates and episodes in due course. So have a great day.
You know what? Hold on. We've got 5 questions for you.
Okay.
How about that? We play this silly kind of game on the show. It's called 5 Questions with Security Weekly. So, okay. Stuart, are you ready to play 5 questions with Security Weekly?
Go for it.
3 words to describe yourself.
A frustrated guitarist.
If you were a serial killer, what would be your weapon of choice?
It would be a PRS guitar.
If you wrote a book about yourself, what would the title be?
If Elvis was alive today, he would be a privacy lawyer.
In the popular game of Ask Grabby Grabby, do you prefer to go first or second?
Both.
Choose 2 celebrities to be your parents.
Alive, dead, fictional, or otherwise.
Oh, this is absolutely fantastic for me. So it would be Elvis, Aaron, Presley, and I think Marilyn Monroe, because I am such an American file. I'm stuck in that era.
Outstanding.
Awesome.
Stuart, thank you so much for appearing on the show today.
It's a pleasure. Thanks for having me, guys.
With that, we'll take a short break and come back with our next segment, which I believe is a preview of our new show for security and compliance called Security and Compliance Weekly. Stay tuned.